So the title of our topic for today is, of course, breaking, and in particular, flow. Flow. Tell the person beside you, flow. Let the grace of God flow. Alright, before we continue with the topic, can I invite you again to stand up and let's pray our favorite prayer at the feast. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today I receive all of God's love for me. Today I open myself to unbounded, limitless, overflowing abundance of God's universe. Today I open myself to God's blessings, healing, and miracles. Today I open myself to God's word, so that I become more like Jesus every day. Today I proclaim that I'm God's beloved, I'm God's servant, I'm God's powerful champion. And because I am blessed, I'm blessing the world. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I pray the Holy Spirit will speak to us, Lord. Even me, I'm not worthy, O God, to even preach your word. But only say the word, Lord God, and I'll be healed. I'll be healed from all of my unworthiness and imperfections. And even each and every one of us who are here, O God, prepare their hearts, Lord God. Open their hearts that they may be able, O God, to understand and fully embrace the message to be proclaimed today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 His name is Paul, right? But before he became Paul, what was his name before he became Paul? Saul. That was his name before he became Paul. And you know, my friends, when Christianity was just starting, when the Holy Spirit has descended into the lives of many people, And the Holy Spirit just multiplied the new believers of Jesus Christ. Here comes Paul, or here comes Saul, who was the enemy of the early believers. And he was really very, very angry. He was very, very furious at what was happening. Because there are really groups of people who are deviating from their Jewish tradition. And they are the new believers of Jesus Christ. So this is, you know, the setting of message, brothers and sisters. Acts 9:1-2, in the meantime, Saul kept up his violent threats of murder against the followers of the Lord. So he was threatening the early followers of the Lord with murder. He went to the high priest and asked for letters of introduction to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he should find there any followers of the way of the Lord, he would be able to arrest them, both men and women, and bring them back to Jerusalem. So, brothers and sisters, what could be happening in the life of Paul during that time? What was the thought that was running in his mind when he was trying to kill and murder the new believers, the new followers of Jesus Christ? What could be the thought that was running in his mind? I believe that this was the thought that was running in his mind, that if you don't believe what I believe, you deserve to be punished. If you don't believe what I believe, you deserve punishment, you deserve death. And actually, this kind of thinking is happening nowadays, isn't it? Yes. Let's take a look at the extremists, whether you're a Muslim extremist or Christian extremist or Jewish extremist or Hindu extremist. This kind of thinking is what's shaping their mind, that if you don't believe what I believe, you deserve to be punished. This is what's happening in our country, in the Philippines, right? In Marawi, yes. The extremists just went to Marawi and just kill, because we don't believe what they believe. You know, we don't believe what they believe. They just kill. But sometimes, brothers and sisters, we don't realize that, we're like these terrorists sometimes. Not big terrorists, but, small terrorists. Amen? In some other ways. But let me ask you this question. What would be the most, the worst sin that you and I could ever commit in this life? What could be the worst sin that we could commit in this life? I believe, my dear friends, that without batting an eyelash, the worst sin that we could ever commit is the sin of pride. Especially spiritual pride or religious pride. And this is exactly the sin that Paul was committing when he was planning to threaten, the early believers of the Lord. Spiritual pride. And as I said a while ago, sometimes we're like little terrorists that because of pride, we are willing to destroy the unity in the body of Christ because of pride. So, my dear friends, what does the Bible say about pride? What does the Bible say about pride? Proverbs 16:18. Can we read it all together? Pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. In other words, if there's pride in your heart, God will break you. If there's pride in your heart. Wow, this is heavy, isn't it? If we have pride, especially spiritual or religious pride, God will surely break us. But you know, this is the good news. That when God is breaking you, He's not actually punishing you. But it's God's way of saving you. Amen? This is the good news, that when you are going through the process of breaking, God is not actually punishing you, but He is saving you. Let's continue with the life of Paul in verse 3. As Saul was coming near the city of Damascus, suddenly a light from the sky flashed around him and he fell to the ground. So brothers and sisters, Saul literally fell to the ground. Nahulog mula sa kabayo na kanyang sinasakyan. You know, he fell literally to the ground. So my dear friends, again, if there's pride in your heart, if there's pride in my heart,
Your breaking is coming. Your breaking is coming. If there's pride in your heart. But the good news is, even if you know you are going through the process of breaking, God is not actually punishing you, but is actually saving. Amen. I still remember when before we came here in Australia. Well, most of you, you know my background, you know Agnes' background. 20 years working in a utility company in the Philippines. And I was so confident that the moment we land in Australia, I would be able to find a job. That was the confidence that I had. And even Agnes, she was talking with me that the moment she will land here in Australia, she will be able to find a job. She was so confident. And you know, my friends, when you are too confident, sometimes you are not aware that a spirit of pride is already, you know, reigning in your heart. And when we came here, as I've been always telling in my talk, it was a different story. Because before Agnes will be able to find a job in the accounting, it took her 8 months, you know? 8 months of you know, being in the process of breaking. It took her 8 months before landing an accounting job. And for me, it took me 18 months. Meaning to say, I am probably prouder than Agnes, you know? So I needed to shift career in order for me to find a more stable job. I needed to change career. I needed to study for 18 months in order to find a more stable job. In other words, God allowed us to go through the process of breaking in order to expose our hearts. You know, when you are proud, you don't even realize that you are proud. Right? You don't realize it. You will only realize when you're already going through the process of breaking. As I said a while ago, that when God is breaking you, He's not actually punishing you. He's actually saving you. That's why, you know, after the breaking of Saul became Paul, isn't it? After that experience, you know, when Jesus struck him while he was in his way to kill, you know, the new believers of the way, Saul became Paul. And for me, after 18 months of studying, Engineer Domingo became Nurse Domingo. More compassionate, more understanding, more loving, more embracing, and hopefully more humble. And Agnes, what's your title? It's okay. And yes, my friends, so the point that I'm telling you right now is that, you know, when there's pride in your heart, God will break you. Not because He wanted to punish you, but because He wanted to save you. Alright, let's continue with the story of this man. So he fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" he asked. "I am Jesus, whom you persecute," the voice said. "But get up and go into the city, where you will be told what you must do." You know, brothers and sisters, I really love this question from the Lord. "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" You know, when we're doing something wrong with other people,
For example, we are abusing other people. Jesus Christ will ask this question, why are you abusing me? When we are hurting other people, Jesus Christ would ask this question, why are you hurting me? When we are angry at other people, Jesus Christ would ask this question, why are you angry at me? When we hate others, Jesus Christ would ask this question, why do you hate me? But when we love other people, or we embrace other people, we welcome them, we forgive them, we are nice to them, Jesus would say these words to us, my son, my daughter, thank you for welcoming me. Thank you for loving me back. Thank you for accepting me into your home. And my dear friends, this is a reality that everything you do to another human being, you do to God. Amen?
Amen.
Everything you do to another human being, whether that's good or bad, you do it to God. Why? Because each and every one of us, we are God container. God lives in us. Whatever we do to other people, we do it to God. Okay, let's continue. Acts 9:7-9. The men who were traveling with Saul had stopped, not saying a word. They heard the voice but could not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground and opened his eyes, but could not see a thing. So they took him by the hand and led him into Damascus. For 3 days he was not able to see, and during that time he did not eat or drink anything. So brothers and sisters, what could be the reason why Saul fell to the ground? Because he was struck with a bright light from heaven, right? But that's not only the reason. I believe that the main reason is for God, for Jesus to expose what was in his heart, to expose his spiritual blindness. The reason why he fell to the ground is to expose his spiritual blindness. I'd like you to know, my dear friends, that your spiritual light is the foundation of your life. Amen? Our spiritual lights. That's the foundation of our lives. That even if we're successful in other areas of our lives, like career, you know, social life, health or family, but if our spiritual life is weak, wow, the totality of our lives will also be unstable, or will also be weak. Your spiritual life is the foundation of your life. So we need, you know, to make it sure that our relationship with God, our relationship with Jesus, is really stable. It's really, you know, established. The relationship is intact. Amen?
Amen?
And this is the point, that when God breaks you, He really is not breaking you. He's exposing the brokenness that's already there. You know, when God allows us to go through the process of breaking, He's not actually breaking us. He's exposing the brokenness that's already there. Amen? Can we read all together so that we'll be able to absorb this truth? When God breaks you, He really is not breaking you. He's exposing the brokenness that's already there. So each and every one of us, we have our own issues, right? We have our own issues. You have your issue, I have my own issue. And sometimes we are not aware of our issues. But God, you know, in His goodness and His kindness, will allow you to go through the process of breaking in order to expose that issue. And His goal is not to punish us, but actually to save us, to deliver us from that slavery, from that bondage that has been slaving us probably for years. When God breaks you, He's not actually breaking you. He's exposing the brokenness that's already there. And you know, my dear friends, when you start opening up your life, When you start realizing that you are broken, you start opening up your life to God. When you realize that, wow, I have a lot of issues, I have a lot of brokenness, you start opening your life. And when your life is opened, the grace of God starts to flow. Amen?
Amen.
When your life is opened, the grace of God starts to flow. And when the grace of God is already flowing in your life, healing is taking place. Yes? Tell the person beside you, healing is taking place. You know, when you start opening your life to God, when you realize that you are broken and you start opening your life to God, God's grace will start to flow and healing starts to touch every broken part of your life. So in other words, brokenness equals openness. You know, when you realize, you know, you need to realize that, yeah, you need God, so that His grace will just flow. And you experience His healing love, His healing touch. I still remember this experience that I have back home. You know, I've been serving the Lord in the community for years already. Actually, I have celebrated my 38th year in community last July. So 30 years in the life of Jesus family, wow. So it's a long time, long time. So I have witnessed how our community just evolved from one structure to another. And before 1997, we didn't have any feasts. We didn't have any prayer meeting like this. It was a different structure. So it would take a lot of time for me to explain the structure, okay? So I don't go into that detail. So in 1997, that's where our community started the feast. The feast. And we call it the happiest place on earth. Why? Because every time we have a feast, God is here. Amen? So that's, you know, that's our slogan. And there was only one feast during the time. It was in Teatro Aguinaldo, 1997. So Brother Alan was there, and I suppose he knows about it, Sister Ellie. And yeah, it was a once-a-month feast. But it was gathered by thousands of people. So Brother Bo was the one preaching. And in 2003, Brother Bo requested me to be one of the regular worship leaders of the feast. So there were three sessions, morning, and then mid-morning, and then afternoon. So I was the worship leader in the afternoon session. Regular. In other words, I lead worship before thousands of people. So it's a bit of a challenge, my dear friends, because you know, it's a bit easier to talk in front of 40 people than to lead worship before thousands of people, because you know, you cannot afford to commit a mistake. So you have to be very prepared before you step in on stage. And yes, I really thought that God was really using me, and I enjoyed what I was doing. But sometimes, you know, when you serve the Lord, there are a lot of challenges, right? There are a lot of trials. And one time, before I led worship in the afternoon, I have this verbal argument with Agnes. Okay? 30 minutes before I lead worship. So you can just imagine, you know, I'm going to lead worship in front of thousands of people, and we were quarreling, you know, in front of, before leading the worship. But I cannot already back down, you know, because nobody would lead the worship. So I just entrusted everything to God, Lord. I just trust everything unto you. You know who we are, you know, we are weak. And yes, brothers and sisters, when I was already leading the worship, wow. I see that God was not there. I see that the Holy Spirit was absent. I was gasping for breath. So it was like I was drowning. There was no inspiration coming in. And it was not a good worship. And I'm sure that many people there just noticed what was happening. And the following day, an elder called me up. And he asked me, Emer,
what happened to you yesterday. You are not your usual self. What happened? You know, my dear friends, instead of humbly telling this elder that, sorry bro, because I have a verbal argument with Agnes before I did worship, I'm so sorry. You know, instead of humbly accepting and telling him the real score of what had happened to us, you know, a day before, I just told him, nothing is happening. Why are you complaining? What's your complaint? You know? I am okay. You know, we are okay. You know, my dear friends, if there's pride in your heart, you don't even realize that there's pride. You know? And to make things worse, after a week, I resigned as a worship leader. I tendered my resignation to Brother Bob. And of course, Brother Bob accepted it. Right? I think that was 2006 and 2007. Our community has decided already to conduct the feast weekly. It's already a weekly feast. And I was expecting that, God will call me back again to lead worship. I wasn't expecting that God would use me again to minister to people. But you know, my dear friends, God has closed the door. And Brother Bo or any other elder, nobody was inviting me, you know, to go back and lead worship. And every time I attended the feast during the time, weekly feast, you know, my heart was really crying. My heart was breaking. Because I realized that when you are out of service, wow, it's really different. You've been serving the Lord all your life, and then you are stagnant, and you're not doing anything. Wow, it's heavy. And I was telling the Lord, Lord, call me back again. I want again to lead worship. I want again to praise you. I want again to, you know, inspire other people. But God did not listen to me. The door was really closed until we came here in Australia. And then when I realized that God was allowing me to go through the process of breaking, when I realized that, wow, I told God, Lord, even if just a simple service, I'm willing just to go back and serving you again. Even just, trying to carry those speakers during prayer meeting, it's okay. Even if just trying to fix the chairs during the feast gathering, it's okay. As long as I'll be able to come back and serve you again and follow you and do the purpose that you have set in my heart. That was my prayer before we came here in Australia. And my dear friends, when we arrived here in Australia, God has other plans. He heard my prayer. He restored me back. Not anymore as a worship leader, but as a preacher of His word. And I started preaching the word in 2012. You know, from a very boring preacher. Up to at this point, I don't know what happened to me. Did I improve, brothers and sisters? Yeah. For 5 years, brothers and sisters, you know, sharing and delivering the word. I really believe that God has called me to do this this task of sharing His word. And yes, God restored me back. You know, when you ask for forgiveness, when you go to God and ask for forgiveness, God will restore you back. And He will accept you again. So at this point, brothers and sisters, I don't know what's happening to you. I don't know. But I believe that each and every one of us who are here, there is this brokenness in our lives. And probably some of you are going through this process of breaking. But again, God is not actually punishing you. He is actually saving you. And this is what He did to Saul. He did not punish Saul, but He saved Saul. That's why he became Paul, an engineer to mingle after 18 months, became nurse to Mingo. You know, giving medication to patients, trying to bandage their wounds, wiping their bum, you know? You know, when you're a nurse here, even if you're a clinical nurse, you will do that, all right? Even the doctors, they will do it if it's needed. That's, you know, how it is here in Australia. It's very different from our country, isn't it? That you, if you're a doctor or nurse in our country, wow, you only do this. But here, it's different. You do all these sort of things. But what's good, my dear friends, that, yes, after these 18 months of breaking, your brother become more compassionate, more embracing, more understanding, more forgiving, more loving. So here it is, your breaking becomes your blessing. Amen?
Amen.
When you go through your process of breaking, that breaking becomes your blessing. Tell the person beside you, your breaking becomes your blessing. Our brokenness is the place where we experience our greatest blessings. You know the reason why, brothers and sisters? You know the reason why your breaking becomes your blessing? Because through the cracks of your broken heart, grace leaks into your life. And through the same cracks, grace leaks out to other broken hearts around you. In other words, you become a wounded healer. You know, after going through this breaking moment in your life, and you experience God's healing touch, God's healing love, God will use you to heal other people who are also experiencing the same hurt or the same brokenness like you before. Grace leaks into your life, and through the same cracks, grace leaks out to other broken hearts around. And when we were having this small group sharing yesterday, and Brother Randy was here, he shared something about his past. And if you read the his sharing, okay, in the, what's that? In our book. So in our program, you know? So this is not already a secret, this is already public. But according to his sharing, yesterday there are a lot of people approaching him, you know? And they were surprised, bro, we didn't know that, you know, this is your background. And we are really inspired by your sharing. We are really inspired how God has touched you, how God has transformed you and changed you to be the person that you are right now. From, you know, being this person to being this person in the Lord, wow. He's inspiring, you know, a lot of people. And through this brokenness, God use it to inspire, to encourage, and heal others. So my dear friends, as I end this, you know, this message, let me ask you this question. Have you experienced being broken before? Have you experienced breaking? Yes. If you haven't experienced being broken, don't worry, because your breaking is coming. Amen? Don't worry. Because, you know, if you want to be used by the Lord, you will expect breaking. Because God, remember this. Remember this. Listen carefully. Because God can never use somebody who is proud and arrogant. God can never use somebody in His vineyard to serve Him or to follow Him who is so proud and full of arrogance. If you decided to follow the Lord, He will allow you to pass to the process of prayer. He will expose your heart. Not to punish you, but to save you.
Amen?
To deliver you. And to make you the person that He wanted you to be. And after you're breaking, you are already a different person. You are a different person. A better person. More humble. And more dependent on God. Amen?
Amen.
Can we give a loud offering to God? Hallelujah!
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Can you invite this to our brothers and sisters? Just want to thank the Lord.